Let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we are delighted to be able to come and to study your word. We ask that you would open our minds and open our ears and open our understanding, that we would truly see the beauty and the glory of Jesus in the book of Revelation. And we ask and pray that you would anoint James once again tonight and use him as your servant in Christ's name. Amen.
Well, good evening, church. Good to see you tonight, everyone. We are in Revelation. I want to tell you a little bit about what I see here tonight as we get into our third meeting, really. And tonight's meeting is entitled Salvation in Jesus. Covering Revelation 7 to 12, we're not going to actually cover all of that tonight. We're going to jump around a little bit because there's just so much in this book, and I'm realizing that sometimes it's better to go a little slower and unpack it than it is to rush through the whole thing and try to cover everything. My wife and I have been married for 25 years. This year is our 25th silver anniversary coming up. We have a 21-year-old son. We have a 16-year-old daughter. The first year of our marriage did not pass without us needing marriage counseling. Now you're going to think, this guy is so messed up. By the time this week is over, you're going to think, I can't believe this guy's a preacher. How could he be a preacher? His life is so messed up. I told you about my alcoholic background, and I was raised in a single-parent home, raised by my mom, so I didn't have a dad. And my wife was raised in a single-parent home. She didn't have a dad either. So there's another mess up right there. So, but to be honest with you, I'm just telling you these things so that you know that I'm a sinner, and I'm just assuming that you are, at least some of you I'm sure are, and we're all messed up, we're all sinners saved by grace. And I think that God wants us, as we've looked in Revelation 7 churches, to be real with Him. He knows where we are, He knows what we're struggling with, He knows what our weaknesses are and our strengths are, and He wants us to be real with Him, so because He can deal with it. He's got big shoulders and He can deal with us. Now, people don't always relate to us nicely, and we don't always get accepted by them and pats on the back because of the revelations we give to them. But Jesus is different. He's not like a person, like any person. God has a heart for each one of us, and He loves us. So I feel very secure in Christ, but I think I could tell you just about anything about myself and even current issues and not worry about it, because the most important thing for me is how Jesus sees me and the work that He's doing in my heart and in my life. So we're a year into marriage and we're going to marriage counseling. Now back then I was a very righteousness by works, even though I wouldn't admit that, focused person. It was, you know, I was moving in the general direction of this righteousness by faith. I didn't fully understand it. I had embraced it as a non-Adventist. When I first became a Christian, it was all Jesus and none of me. But as I started studying with the Adventists, I told you I was raised a Catholic, and people would tell me when I became an Adventist, members would say, "Oh, Adventists make Catholics make the best Adventists," and they meant that in a very positive way. You know, Catholics make the best Adventists. But I learned in time that the reason why Catholics make the best Adventists, at least for me, is because Catholics, by and large, want to do what is right. I mean, even when I was out in the world, I still said my prayers every night, whether I was drunk or sober. I still went to church. When I went back home, my mom made me go to confession. I still went to confession. I still went to church at Christmas, and I still went to church at Easter, you know. We want to do what we're supposed to do. And so when I became an Adventist, I found out not only am I supposed to do these things, but these things are the things that are in the Bible. So now I'm really going to do them, you know. So Catholics make the best Adventists, but they don't always transition from that works-orientated theology to a grace-centered relationship with Christ. Now, the reason why I say that is because that, I believe, is the basis of the book of Revelation. It is the basis of the Bible. The Bible starts in Genesis with relationship. Adam and Eve walking in the cool of the day with their maker. And Satan comes in to try to destroy that relationship so that Adam and Eve are hiding from their maker. And of course, God pursues them. In other words, God pursues relationship. Now we see the same picture taking place in Revelation. It begins with these churches, and Jesus is with the churches. He's among them. He's pursuing relationship. And the summation of the churches, if you think about it, the worst church in the book of Revelation is the last church. It's the Laodicean church. It's in such bad condition that God says, you make me want to throw up. And the remedy for that church, the remedy for that church is relationship with Jesus. Think about it. There's this picture in Revelation chapter 3 of Jesus knocking on the door. And he wants to come in. And what does he want to do? Why does he want to come in? He wants to sup with us, right? And us with him. And when you think about food, when you think about eating together, what do you think of? Nourishment. Fellowship, right? Now, my wife is Hispanic and Puerto Rican and Mexican American, and she has 16 uncles and aunts. A couple of them passed away, but they have a big family. Most of them live in Bakersfield. And when I first met her and we went to Bakersfield for a family reunion, these guys rent a gym. And it's just big. And everyone's just talking and visiting. And that's the way, I mean, I wasn't necessarily raised that way per se, but at least every Sunday we had a big family get together around, a big dinner. And so there's this fellowship that takes place. The idea here in Revelation is that God wants to fellowship with us. He wants to hang out with us. And of course we see that in Revelation, because Revelation talks about the marriage supper. Now, when you think about marriage and supper, that's real fellowship. So you get the picture. There's romance here. Revelation 21 talks about the bride of Christ. There's romance, there's relationship that's taking place. And so as we look at the book of Revelation from this perspective, there's a different picture that we get. Back to my story. My wife and I are about a year into marriage, and we need marriage counseling. It's very embarrassing for me. I'm a very straight-laced. I got everything right. You know, the toothpaste is squeezed from the bottom. The toilet paper's on the right. Everything's in order, right? I need marriage counseling? I mean, you know, I'm going to go to a pastor, and he's going to come into my home, and he's going to counsel my wife and I because we're not really getting things together. I'm a preacher. I need marriage counseling. What? So it was very humiliating to admit it, but I did. Now, the reason why it was even harder is because when we got married, I was determined for my wife to know that I loved her. So not only was I going to work, you know, 5-6 days a week, whatever it took, not only was I going to go out there and work hard so I could bring home the stripples, but I was also going to help her in the home. I was going to make sure that I did part of the housework. So I told her, I said, honey, I will clean the bathroom and I will vacuum the floor, because I want you to know that I'm here for you and I love you. Of course, we lived in a little apartment then, and it was just kind of a daylight basement apartment. And so it just had a little bathroom and a little living room area. It didn't take a lot. But after we, you know, built a house, we had a couple of bathrooms and it was bigger. And so it took a little, but I was stuck to it. I just wanted her to know that I loved her. So we sit down with this pastor, and he proceeds to tell us that my wife is showing all the signs of insecurity. She's just not secure. She's just not sure. And she's in tears at this point. She's just not sure that I love her. And I am literally at my wit's end. Now, I don't exude that. I don't reveal that, because I'm a pastor and I'm a preacher, you know, so I'm just very calm. And I explained to him, you know, that can't be, because I'm providing for her financially. And not only am I bringing home the stripples, but I'm also vacuuming and cleaning the bathroom. I mean, there's no way my wife can not know that I love her. And so he suggests that we read a book. Now, I've read many, many books since then that have to do with marriage and relationships, and they've all been helpful. But this book was a game changer. the book, Five Languages of Love. You ever heard of that book? Five Languages of Love. Oh, me, oh my. That really opened my eyes. And I realized that I have been communicating to my wife love in my language, not hers. As far as she was concerned, I was speaking Chinese. And she didn't get it one bit. She wasn't hearing any kind of love. She wasn't feeling any kind of love. Well, she was feeling some kind of love, but it wasn't the kind of love that she needed. Because her main love language, and if you haven't read the book, you may not be able to follow here, so let me just give you the quick. The Languages of Love is a book about how that we communicate love in these five different ways. Gifts, words of appreciation, acts of service, physical touch, and physical quality time. Why did I forget quality time? Because because that last one is my wife's love language. And you know, I'm preaching and I'm teaching and I'm vacuuming and I'm cleaning the bathroom. You want me to sit down on the couch and talk to you for 30 minutes? I don't know if I have 30 minutes. Look at all the things I'm doing for you. And so as we got done with that counseling session, the pastor basically said, you know, James, your wife doesn't need, it's not that you shouldn't do it, but your wife doesn't need you to do all those things. What she needs from you is to sit down on the couch with her every night and just give her 30 minutes. Oh, you got to understand, I was a hyper guy back there. I just thought, oh. But I did it. And I realized, as I never even thought, I mean, I had in my mind, I had no idea that this would work. But it's exactly what my wife needed. She needed me to communicate love to her in her language. Her father had left home, split up when she was young. She didn't have a father figure. He didn't have time. There wasn't always time. And she felt that need. Now me, I was raised in a home in London. My mom raised us as a single mom. She was a teacher. She was gone a lot. We lived in it was an older home, one of those old British fireplace in every room, even the kitchen type homes. But it didn't have, you know, the basics like we didn't have a phone. We didn't have hot water in the kitchen. We didn't have a refrigerator. We didn't have a vacuum cleaner. And so we didn't have a washer and dryer. And so it took a lot of work, you know, to keep things going. And my mom was, you know, working all week and tired on the weekend. So I would do a lot of the work. I would do a lot of the cleaning and I would do laundry and I would go shopping and I would, you know, do all of these things. And I was just raised that way. And it was just natural for me to just do acts of service. So it wasn't difficult for me to vacuum the floor. I mean, I didn't even have a vacuum when I was a kid. It wasn't difficult for me to clean the bathroom. And so I really wasn't giving something that was unnatural to me. I really wasn't communicating love in the language of my wife, in what she needed. I was communicating love in my own language. I was loving myself. I like a clean house. And so when I realized this, a whole new dimension understanding opened up to my mind. And I started reading the Bible in the context of these languages of love. Now, I specifically study the book of Hebrews, but I'm going to bring it into the book of Revelation tonight because I believe it's so much there. The book of Hebrews is a relational book. It's all about relationship. Paul is pleading with the Hebrews, with the Jews, that they've missed. They've gotten into the theology, into the doctrine. In fact, that book is for Adventists, I think. But they have missed relationship with Christ. And so he begins by introducing relationship with Christ. And in the first, well, all the way through the book, you have all these love languages. You have in John, Hebrews chapter 1, God giving his son for our sins. That's the gift, the language of giving, the language of gifts. In chapter 2, you have Jesus becoming a man. That's the physical touch. He became one with the human family. And in chapter 4, you have that quality time, the rest, entering into his rest. And in chapter 7, you have Jesus ever living to make intercession for us. That's the acts of service. He's always working in our behalf. And in chapter 11, you have this entire chapter in Hebrews that just talks about the faithful of past ages And it describes, you know, Abraham, and it describes Moses, and it describes Noah. And if you read Hebrews 11 carefully, you're going to find that there is nothing negative ever said about any of those faithful believers of the Old Testament. I mean, he talks about how Noah, you know, went out, didn't even know where he was going. Doesn't talk about how he lied in chapter 14 of Genesis about Sarah being his wife. Said he, you know, she was his sister. It talks about Moses, you know, and how he chose to suffer with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. Let's talk about how Moses killed that Egyptian and hit him in the sand. I mean, Samson's mentioned in there. Rahab, none of the sins, none of the failures. It's all positive. That's words of affirmation. That's the language of that's my weakest love language, by the way, because I'm a perfectionist. So I'll come home, you know, my wife might have fixed me a great meal. And I'll say, oh man, the kitchen's a mess. You know, I mean, just, oh, every time I just mess up. Told you, you're going to think at the end of this that I, you know. So, but this is the way revelation is communicated also. For example, the seven churches. Jesus wants a relationship with us. He's there for us. He wants physical association. The churches are filled with this kind of language of love. The book of Revelation is filled with this language of love. Revelation 1:5. He's loved us and washed us from our sins in his blood. That's the greatest gift that God, that all heaven could give. And then you have these words of affirmation all through the seven churches over and over again. You've got this and you're doing this and you're doing well here and you're doing well there. And by the way, I was so convicted about these love languages and so intrigued with the book of Revelation and the number 7. You know, 7, 7, 7, 7. I thought, if these love languages are biblical, because the book I read didn't really tie them to the Bible, and I wanted to do that. I don't like psychology unless it's tied to the Word of God. And so I went into the book of Hebrews, and I said, I wonder if there are 7 love languages instead of 5. You know, I was just wondering. And sure enough, I found 2 more in the book of Hebrews that I didn't see in that book. You know what they are? You want to know? Oh, you do? Okay, good. So you all kind of zombie now. I thought maybe you ate too much for dinner and just kind of, no? You all right? Hebrews chapter 12 and Hebrews chapter 13 give us 2 additional love languages. You have the first 5. Gifts, physical touch, acts of service, words of affirmation, and the one I missed, quality time. Okay. And then there's 2 more. In Hebrews chapter 12, God says, as many as I love, I chasten. And that's, of course, Revelation chapter 3, too. One of God's love languages is rebuke. It's chastening. It's correction. And the last one, Hebrews 13, God says, I, verse 5, will never leave you nor forsake you. The last love language is commitment. God is committed to us, and he wants us to be committed to each other and to him. So, I think it's interesting that these last 2 love languages are primarily the ones that are missing, not just from this book, but from society today. Think about it. In society today, this idea of correcting people, of reproving people, of disciplining your children, people shy away from that in society today. Have you noticed that? And look what it's done. And then, and by the way, my mom never hesitated to discipline us in public. We could be on a bus, we could be on the street, didn't matter where we were. I tell you what, she would turn around and she would just give us a spanking on the behind right there in public. She didn't care who was watching and what was going on. Try to do that today. And then, this whole idea of commitment. Nobody wants to commit to anything and never mind each other. So you have these 2 love languages that I think are really being undermined by society, the secular society at large today. And God wants to restore love. Now, love is a word that, oh, I love. My kids will say, I love Taco Bell. I love that car. Ooh, oh, I love that. We just use that word, just freely use that word. And it's lost meaning. It's lost substance. What does it mean to love? And so when I see that word in the context of the languages of love, how we communicate it, We communicate love by giving gifts. We communicate love by service. We communicate love by quality time, by words of affirmation. We communicate love by physical touch. We communicate love by being faithful to correct and being committed to each other and to others. This is how we communicate. This is what love looks like in action. And this is what we see in the book of Revelation. God is committed to us. So he's with us. He's touching us. He gives us gifts. He gives us words of affirmation. And he gives us words in the seven churches of correction. He doesn't want to leave us or forsake us. He's made powerful promises to us because he wants to know that he's with us until the end. Now, Revelation chapter 5, we'll pick up there. We left off there last night. The story continues. The relationship continues. And by the way, what God wants for us, Revelation 21, is that we will be his bride. He's romancing us. I'm so glad when my wife and I were dating that because I told her, I said, you know, we're never going to fight. We'll never get in an argument. Was I naive, right? I'm so glad we got in an argument before we got married. Can you imagine never getting in an argument before you're married, and then you get married, and then you get in an argument, and you're like, whoa. That was a shocker. So I'm so glad that we actually got in an argument. In fact, we got in several arguments before we got married. It was really good. It was really enlightening. A revelation of reality. So God, in the context of the book of Revelation, is wooing us and dating us. And he's bringing us to the place where we will fall in love with him. Relationship. And of course, love is a two-way experience. Love is something that goes both ways. And he wants us to fall in love with him because he is absolutely sold out in love with us. Isn't that amazing? God loves us. Loves us. So as you move through the book of Revelation, you begin to see these love languages being communicated. And by the way, I'm learning that even though my wife's number one love language is quality time and number two love language is physical touch, which is my number two love language, my number one love language is, does anyone know what my number one love language is? Acts of service. You got it. So I'm learning that at the same time, that doesn't mean that I shouldn't communicate to her in the other love languages. I believe God wants us to communicate in all the love languages. And when I really want to knock my wife off her feet, I'm just going to bring all the love languages. I'm just going to bombard her with every one of them, you know, and just watch her reaction. Oh, yeah, just fill that cup up. And that's what God does for us. He knows our needs. He knows what it takes for us individually to feel secure in his love. Some of us, it's going to be words of affirmation. Others, it's going to be acts of service. Others, it's going to be the gifts. These are the big ones. But by and large, he communicates to us in all of the love languages, every single one of them. By the way, for those of you who are married or dating or in relationships, do you know what your wife or husband's love language is? I'm not asking for hands or anything. And if you do you communicate love in those languages? And if you don't, or you've never heard of this before, this is new to you, do you think you can figure it out by tomorrow? Or even now? And think about it. Think about relationship. And if you've never thought about this before, think about, you know, what you think. And you could even ask him or her, what do you think your number one love language is? And what's your number two? And start accentuating those particular languages of love in relationship and see what happens, what takes place. So, Revelation chapter 5, God is communicating to us in this language of gift, in this language of giving himself for our sins. And that's what we see. We looked at this last night in the context of the Lamb in the midst of the throne slain for our sins. Now, we highlighted a specific word here last night, and that word is found in Revelation chapter 5 and verse 5. It says here, "And one of the elders said unto me, Weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered." Is that what your version says? Anyone else got a different word? Triumphed. Any other words? prevailed, right? Prevailed? Okay. Mine's the prevailed. Conquered is, in a sense, it's more accurate because it connects with what we're going to read in chapter 6 in just a minute. But does anyone have another word? Does anyone have the word overcome? Overcame? Is that what it says in there? In the Young's Literal, it's overcome. Now, that's probably the more consistent translation. And I say that because it's the same word that is referenced in every one of the churches to him that overcomes, to him that overcomes, to him that overcomes. It's the same word. And the reason why this is important is because this word, as I mentioned last night, is going to connect all the way through the book of Revelation. It's going to lead us to on a trajectory that's going to give us a storyline that points us to this experience of trusting in Christ or righteousness by faith, trusting in the righteousness of Christ and what he has done that we couldn't do. We need to overcome, but we're not able to overcome. So Jesus has stepped in because no man in heaven and no man in earth and no man under the earth can change our destiny with death. We talked about this last night. The book is sealed. It's set. And no man can alter it. No man in heaven, no man in earth, no man under the earth. That book contains the history of the world, your history and my history. And it's summarized in the verse. The wages of sin is death. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through who? Jesus Christ. It's through Jesus Christ. And what is it? It's a gift. So here's the love language being communicated again. Do you like to receive gifts? I love to receive gifts, especially big ones. When I was a kid, we lived in Hawaii, and my mom and dad met in Oceanside, Camp Pendleton. They were both in the Marine Corps. And my dad was black, and my mom was white. Now, back then, in the late 50s, I was born in 62, a white woman and a black man in Southern California in the Marine Corps, that wasn't going to work. And my dad had already had a marriage that he was divorced, and so he had a wife and kids that he had to support. And so my mom and dad fell in love. And they started having this clandestine relationship, you know, this secret relationship. And they didn't want anyone to know about it, you know. And every once in a while, my mom would tell me, every once in a while, you know, we'd get pulled over. A police officer would see us together, and they'd pull us over. And she said she remembers my dad would be driving the car, and the police officer would come to the window, and he'd look through the window past my father, right through to her, and he would say, "Are you all right, ma'am?" She said, these were just the little things that we experienced. It was just a bad, bad time. And so my mom and dad never married. He had a family, and he told her, he said, "I can't marry anyone. I've got to support my family and my three children. Even though I'm divorced, I've got to support them financially. I'm in the Marines." And they never intended to have a family, but my mom got pregnant. Now, my mom was raised Catholic. She was a good girl. She went to college. And just before she got out of college, she ended up kind of going into this rebellious mode. And she left her sister. She was sponsored by her sister from England to the States. And she lived in Idaho. And she left. She ran away. And she joined the Marines. And that's where she met my dad. And they had this romantic relationship, you know. And she fell in love. And he was in love with her. And then she got pregnant with twins. And so she was brought in before the board or whatever, however they did it. And he was brought in before the board, however they did it. You know, I don't know how they did it. And she knew what was going down, and so when they asked her, "Are you in love with this guy?" She said, "No, I don't love him. Not at all. Just a fling, just a relationship, you know." So he was able to maintain his 20 years in the Marine Corps, and my mom got an honorable discharge, you know, because those things happen sometimes. And there she was in Southern California with twins. And what was she going to do? Living in America in 1962 with two kids that were half black. People tell me sometimes I look like Obama. Well, we got a lot in common, you know. His mom was Irish. My mom was Irish. In fact, when I was in Poland, it was funny. They had me, it was 2008, I was at a camp meeting in Poland, and my hair was really short, and I had the suit on, and I put some sunglasses on, and I was at a camp meeting there, and people started calling me Obama, and they had me take pictures with people to raise money. People would pay to take a picture with Obama. You know, so I don't think I look like Obama, but you know, I'm as black as he is, even though I don't, it doesn't show, you know. But so what is she going to do? She's living in this place where, and by the way, I lived in Hawaii when he lived in Hawaii. I think he lived in Hawaii. But anyway, we were there in 73, and supposedly he was there too. And he was born in what, 61? And I was born in 62? So we got a lot in common. He's president of the United States, and I'm a preacher. But I heard that. So, and you know, then it was the 60s. It wasn't just the racism that was rampant, but it was, you know, drug culture, the hippie culture, all of that was on the rise, you know. And so my mom just said, you know, I'm just going to take him back to England. So she took us back to England, and that's where we were raised. We were raised in England. And in that context, you know, it was difficult for us. It was difficult for me to be able to relate, to be able to understand love, and to be able to understand, you know, family and that kind of stuff. So my mom and dad kept in contact, and he went 3 tours Vietnam, and then he got wounded. He was in the hospital for about 18 months, and then he retired in Hawaii. And the reason he retired in Hawaii is because that was one place in the United States that people weren't prejudiced against black people. They were prejudiced against white people in Hawaii. And he really liked that. So they have a Howley Day in Hawaii we lived there. So we moved from England to Hawaii to reconnect as a family. And it lasted about 6 months. You know, too much water under the bridge, whatever, but I was so cool to connect with my dad. And he taught me how to play tennis, and I just really loved him, and we had developed a good relationship, and then later on that was rekindled when I met Reese and we went and visited him. So, and that's another story. So we're in Hawaii, and it's Christmas, and there's these gifts under the tree. Now, we don't have a lot of money. My dad doesn't have a lot of money. He's living on Marine Corps salary, retirement, and my mom doesn't have any money. And it's Christmas, and there's all these gifts under the tree, and I'm like, wow, this is really cool. You know, I love gifts. So Christmas morning, we go over there. We're 11 years old. My sister and I, and we're opening these gifts, and we open this one gift, and it's this really cool, like this little motorhome thing that, you know, as things flip out, you can move it around or whatever, you know. It's just kind of really cool, and that's for me. And my sister opens something. It's a doll, you know, with all the accessories, you know. And then there's all these other gifts there. And so we start opening the other boxes, and I open one box, and it's really heavy, you know, and I open it up, and there's a rock in there. Just a rock. Like, and my dad's, you know, laughing, and then we open another one, and there's another rock in there. And it was just the idea of having all these gifts, but there was really only one. That's all they could afford, was just the one gift, which we were very content with. But just the idea of having all these gifts, it was just exciting as a kid. The world offers us a lot of gifts, but when it's all said and done, it's just a bunch of rocks. But God offers us one gift after another here in the Bible, and especially in the book of Revelation. Now, here's the problem. We get the one gift, and we think, oh, man, this is great. Don't need any more gifts than that one, just that one gift. And we don't realize that we need every single gift that God has to offer us, every one of them. We cannot do a day without receiving from Him the gift that He wants to give us for that day. His presence, His love, His acceptance, His forgiveness. It's not something old. It's not something we did one time and we've been good ever since. God gives us fuller revelations of who He is, of His love. He gives us fuller revelations of who we are, and He gives us a fuller realization of our need for Him. And the greatest danger we have as Laodiceans and as human beings is to depend upon ourselves and not depend upon Him and the gift He has to give us. So this is what we see in Revelation chapter 6. Now I want you to notice this. Jesus takes the scroll. He opens it, or begins to open it, after the elders and the living creatures and everyone in heaven, everyone on the earth, and everyone that is singing this song, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain." And they can't help it. You'll notice that these hymns are sung at specific points in the book of Revelation when some victory has been won by God in Jesus Christ. And they're just singing, they're just praising God. Isn't that the way it is in our lives? You know, when something great happens, or we just want to praise God, or we just want to sing for joy, we're just happy. And that's what we see in the book of Revelation. And then as everyone kind of calms down, you know, they go through the verse a few times. I don't know, maybe 20, 30, 100 times. They go through it, you know. Praise God, this is great. Worthy is the Lamb. And they're exhausted. And they're just kind of tired. And they stop singing. Then, it says in Revelation 6, verse 1, John sees the Lamb opening one of the seals. Now, this is really powerful because what's happening now is you've got this scroll that's sealed up tight. It has the history of the world in it. And we know what the history of that world is. Ezekiel tells us the scroll was sealed up in Ezekiel's day, and in it was weeping and lamentation, mourning and woe. That's what was contained in the scroll in Ezekiel, that Ezekiel was shown, that was sealed up and was written on the inside and the outside. And that's really a summary of the history of this world, weeping, lamentation, and mourning and woe. But when the Lamb gets hold of this, remember what the Lamb represents. What does the Lamb represent in Revelation? Jesus. But specifically what? Calvary, the cross. Yes. When Calvary takes hold of the history of planet Earth and begins to open up this history, Calvary affects your history and mine. Calvary impacts us. That's why I'm here tonight. I'm here because of Calvary. That's why I'm not an alcoholic. That's why I'm married to one woman for 25 years. That's why I live the way I live and do what I do, because of Calvary. Calvary has impacted me. It's changed the course of my history. It's given me a new identity in Jesus. And that's what we see taking place in the symbolic language as these scrolls are open. In fact, there's four horses that come out of this history. Those four horses represent represents the four corners of the earth, north, south, east, and west. God uses four whenever he wants to symbolize or represent the world and every direction of the world and everyone in the world. So basically, these horses represent people. You see the same thing in the parable of the sower and the seed in Matthew 13. Jesus is talking there about the gospel being sown into the field. The field is the world, and the seed of the word goes into all of the world. And it lands in how many different places? Four types of soil. How many of those soils are good soils? One. How many of those soils are bad soils? Three. Same with the horses. Same thing. It's the same truth. In fact, you can parallel in our outline, there's a parallel of the sower and the seed and the four horses. And they match up perfectly. The characteristics are perfect in their parallelism between the two. It's God is giving us the same truth here in Revelation's four horses. And we know that. Historically, we know these horses represent white horse, apostolic age. Red horse, the persecution that followed. The black horse, the dark ages that followed that. And the pale horse, part of the dark ages, then leading into atheism. We know that historically, but when we look at that history, we want to identify the principles, the practical principles that are being revealed here. And first and foremost, we want to recognize that Jesus Christ is impacting the history of the world with the cross revolution. He has done something to change the lives of individuals, of you and me. And we impact others, and that impacts others, and that impacts others, and that impacts others. I was driving, almost got here without incident. When I say without incident, I mean without getting in, you know, heavy traffic. Driving from Loma Linda out here. Phil and I talked last night about going up to 210 instead of going down 10, which is really bad around Ontario where they got the construction going on and there was a car upside down last night. Did I tell you about that? Going the other way. You know how that is. When there's an upside down car, you know, all the traffic on this side stops as well as the traffic on that side. Because those guys are stopping because, you know, the car's on their lane. But this side is stopping. Why? Because they want to see you. Wow! Whoa! And so when we got past the car, of course, the lanes were all clear. So I went up to 210, 215 to 210, and it was just clear. I mean, it was just clear as crystal. Huge freeway, just clear as crystal. So I was driving all the way out, and then I got to the very, just about here, you know, and all of a sudden, you know, the red lights go on. And, you know, as soon as the brake lights go on, everyone's brake lights go on. And everyone's brake lights go on, and we all slow down. I'm thinking, oh, there's a wreck up here or something. And then we all speed up again, and we slow down. Then we speed up again, and we slow down, and we speed up again, and pretty soon we're all going. I'm thinking, what was that? Someone put their brake lights on, and everyone put their brake lights on, and everyone slowed down. That's what it was. There was nothing taking place. But in a positive sense, that is what we can be. Jesus has impacted us with that red blood of His, and our lives can now impact others, that can impact others, that can impact others, that can impact others. And this is the picture that begins to open up before us as we look at what God has accomplished in Jesus Christ. Notice it here. I saw the Lamb open one of the seals, Calvary, the cross. And I heard one of the four living creatures, one of the four beasts say, come and see. And I saw and behold a white horse. And he that sat on him had a bow and a crown was given unto him. And he went forth. What's that phrase? Conquering and to conquer. I love that phrase. Conquering and to conquer. Present tense, future tense. Love it. And that's the same word, by the way. Nikeo, that's the same word that's used where he has prevailed. It's the same word to him that overcomes, to him that overcomes. Now we have this white horse. None of the other horses are described this way because remember, there's three bad and one good. The white horse represents Christ. We know that. We know that Christ is the rider because he rides a white horse in Revelation 19. Who does the horse represent? Well, look at a Bible verse with me in the Old Testament that I think really breaks this open for us. It's in the book Zechariah. You know where Zechariah is? Zechariah is right before Malachi, which is right before Matthew. So if you go to the book of Matthew and you just go back two books, Matthew, Malachi, Zechariah. And you go to Zechariah chapter 10, I think it is. Let's see if I got this right. Zechariah chapter 10. Or maybe it's chapter 9 and verse 10. Keep turning the pages and I'll try to find the verse. Actually, I can't find the verse. I'm not going to look for it anymore because we're running out of time. It's in Zechariah chapter 9 or 10, and it says, oh, here it is. Verses 13 and 14. No, that's not it. I'll find it. Is it 9:10? I will cut off. Yes, where is that? Which one is that? 9:10? I will cut off. I don't see it though. Oh yeah, there it is. Okay. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse. No, that's not it. That's not it. Anyway, there's one in here that says that God has made us his goodly horse in the time of battle. His goodly horse. It's in Zechariah 9 or 10. I should have looked that up before throwing you to it. But have you ever ridden a horse? The first time I ever rode a horse, we came back to the States. I was in seventh grade. We were in Montana. We left Hawaii. We moved to Idaho Falls. That's where my aunt lived. My mom's sister lived. And then from Idaho Falls, we moved to Montana because my mom went to college there and Helena, that's where she spent a lot of time. We settled there for a year and a half and I went to YMCA camp. Now, I'd never been to a camp before. I mean, I wasn't familiar with America at all. And at this camp, you know, you stay in a little cabin with a bunch of guys, kids, and you go out and you learn how to shoot, and learn how to shoot arrows, and you know, you go in canoes and you go horseback riding. Now, I'd never been on a horse before. They said, oh, don't worry about it. It's safe. These horses are trained and they're nice horses. They're not wild horses. You just get on, you just hold the reins, and they'll just trot along together. So I got on this horse along with all these other guys. But the particular horse that I got on had a tricky disposition. When we went down the trail and came up over the hill, about halfway around this course, we were going around, the barns are here, and we go down and we go around and we come up. When that horse that I was on, when he sees the barn again, he wants to go back. Now, he's supposed to stay in line. He's got horses behind him and horses in front of him, so he stays in line. But he decided that he wanted to go back to the barn. And back to the barn he went with me, full gallop. And I'm telling you what, I've never ridden a horse before. I'm like, what do I do? And he said, the guy told me, hold on. He's just going back to the barn. Don't worry about it. Just ride him. I'm like, I don't know how to ride a horse. Have you ever ridden a horse bareback? I had, I don't know if it was the guts or the stupidity to get on a horse bareback. And what they told me to do was basically hold on tight to the horse's hair, to his mane, and take your feet and just stick them right into the, like you're gripping with all your might. Well, I couldn't do it. I felt like I was going to hurt the horse. I had an experience. So then the horse didn't take off, didn't run, nothing like that. He was just walking. And as he was walking and he started going like this, I started just slipping right off. And I just fell right off, because I couldn't stay on. He was just so slick and I wasn't willing to grab hard. In order to ride a horse, you have to stay connected. The rider has to hold on to the horse, grip the horse, direct the horse. And that's the picture we see here in Revelation 6, verse 2. We see a rider and we see a horse. The horses represent people, you and me. And the first horse has a rider whose name is Jesus. And he wants to take the reins of our lives. And he wants to guide us and direct us in the way we should go. He wants to have a relationship, connection with us. You ever seen someone who really knows how to ride a horse? They can do anything and everything. Riding with no hands. I don't know how they do that, riding with no hands. And how do they stay on that horse? It seems like when they're galloping, you're just going to go flying off. How do you get that? The British style is you're pumping like this. They are just connected with that horse. So God is giving us a picture here of a connection that he wants us to have with him. Last night, a couple of questions came to me, and the questions were both the same, and they came from two different people. And the question was, okay, Revelation 7, we need to overcome, we need to overcome, we need to overcome. We need to overcome what? Do we need to overcome? Because whenever you think about we need to overcome, whenever you think about that, you think, well, we need to overcome. We need to overcome sin. We need to overcome, give me a checklist. What is it that you're going to be telling us in this seminar, James? What is it you're going to be telling us we need to overcome specifically? Well, I am going to tell you one thing, just one thing. And everything else will follow. And that one thing is this. We need to overcome relying upon ourselves. Self-reliance. We need to stop relying upon ourselves. And we need to put all of our trust in Jesus. That is the message of the churches. Jesus says, you guys, you think you're rich and increased with goods and you don't need anything. But you don't realize that you're blind and wretched and poor and miserable and naked. You need me. I want you to sup with me. Now, why do we feel that way? Well, because we've been Christians for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, second generation, third generation, fourth generation. We've read the Bible once, twice, three times, four times, five times. We've got scripture memorized. We know all the prophecies. We're way smarter than all those other churches and all those other Christians. We can answer all the Bible questions, or at least we know someone who can. We're just satisfied. We need to overcome self-sufficiency. Jesus had to overcome that. Sometimes we argue, you know, about Christ and did he come in our, was he like us? How was he tempted, you know? And I have to say, honestly, when I look at Jesus, I see someone who was above us in many ways in his human nature. But there's one thing that we share in common that makes him fallen like us, and that is this. He had to resist the temptation to rely upon himself. Remember when the devil came to him in the wilderness? And the devil says, if you're the Son of God, I want you to turn those stones into bread. Remember that? When was the last time you attempted to do that? When was the last time you attempted to turn stones into bread? That'd be a hard temptation, wouldn't it? Oh, man, I'm really hungry. I want to turn that stone into a nice Papa John's pizza right now. Vegetarian, of course. But I better not. Anyone ever been tempted to do that? No. Why? Because you can't do it. Could Jesus have done it? Yes. But if he'd have done it, what would he have been doing? Relying on himself. And Jesus said, I didn't come to rely upon myself. I came to rely upon the Father. I came to do the will of the Father. I can't do anything of myself. What the Father does, that's what I do. And that's where Jesus meets us. He refused to rely upon himself as an example to us, that we would stop relying upon ourselves in whatever way we do, whether it's our tithe paying or our Sabbath keeping. In whatever area, whether it's our victories or our defeats, whether we look at ourselves like Abraham and Sarah and say, you know, there's no way that we're going to have a baby. That is the funniest thing I ever heard. Sarah, you laughing? No, I'm not laughing. You laughed. Or like Paul in Philippians 3, where he says, you know, I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisee. I was circumcised on the eighth day of the Jew, tribe of Benjamin. Law, blameless. But I consider all of that garbage, rubbish, that I might have the righteousness of Jesus Christ. God wants us to overcome self-reliance. That's the bottom line. That's pretty easy. I mean, pretty simple, isn't it? To understand, not pretty easy. Now, how that works, how that happens, is pictured for us in the following sequence of the book of Revelation, up until we get to Revelation chapter 12. In Revelation chapter 12, we're going to see a transition take place. We're going to see a people who have figured out what it is we actually need to overcome. And it's not primarily, now don't misunderstand this, it's not primarily sin. It's not primarily that we need to keep the law. Don't lose me here. Just hold for a second. The call to overcome in Revelation 2 and 3 is not connected with the law. There is no mention of the law of God. There is no mention of a commandment-keeping people in the first half of Revelation. And yet we're called to overcome. The first time there are a people pointed out who keep the commandments of God is in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. It's halfway through the book, or it's past halfway through the book. But something significant takes place before we get to that revelation of those people. And you know what it is? It is the development of a people who have overcome self-reliance, who are connected with Jesus, and follow Jesus wherever he goes. a people who overcome self-reliance by the blood of the Lamb. They put their entire trust in Christ and His righteousness. In fact, they're clothed with His righteousness, Revelation 12:1. I'm getting ahead of myself right now. Tonight, we're just going to close with this story. And I just want you to think about this because it can be overwhelming. What I'm suggesting to you this evening is, I don't care how long you've been a Christian or a Seventh-day Adventist, everything you've ever done in your life is worth zero when it comes to your salvation. You are absolutely disqualified from going to heaven because of anything you've ever done as far as works go or will do. The only hope you have for heaven is to trust in the righteousness, the doing and the dying of Jesus Christ. That's the way it is now, and it's the way it's always going to be. That's the bottom line. Now, that can be overwhelming in a sense because the religion of human nature tends to trust to some degree in what we do. That's why there's not a point that needs to be repeated more frequently or established more firmly in the minds of all as the utter impossibility of man meriting anything by his own best good works. Salvation is in Jesus Christ alone. So it can be overwhelming. But it's good to start somewhere, even if it's here. Illustration. I thought, in being a Christian for many years, that I was doing really well in my physical exercise health. I mean, I just thought I was a healthy guy. I was a Seventh-day Adventist for, 2001, about 20 years, 15 years. Vegan. I got exercise when I could. I was slender, maybe a little too slender. 5'11", and sometimes I dip down to 135 pounds. I'm 175 right now. So picture me 40 pounds lighter. Those were on the trips that I come home from Pakistan. I went there 3 times, and I didn't think anything of it. I thought I was just healthy, you know. I would sometimes be getting ready for a shower or whatever, and I'd go to my wife and I'd suck my ribs and I go, oh, and she'd go, oh, I don't want to look at that. You're so skinny. You need to put weight on. I said, oh, don't worry about it. I don't want to get fat anyway. But in time, I was convinced that I should put on a little bit of weight. Maybe if I could just get to 150 pounds. And so I tried to do that, but I couldn't. There's nothing I could do to gain weight. I'm just a hyper guy. Ty and I went through the same thing together until I was about the age of 39, and I realized at that point that even though I looked healthy, I really wasn't healthy. I was completely out of shape. And so Ty came over to my house one day and he said, James, I figured out how to put on weight. In fact, I weigh 150 pounds right now. Now, the most I could get to is about 140, 145 at the max. And then I'd lose that weight quickly as soon as I would travel somewhere. So I was really intrigued with this. And I asked him, how did you gain 10 pounds? How did you get to 150 pounds? I haven't weighed that since high school. He said, I've been experimenting with lifting weights. I work out, I lift weights. I said, oh, that's so vain. I don't want to. He said, I'm done being skinny. I need to put on weight, and this has worked for me. Come over to my house tomorrow morning, we'll work out together. So I went over there, we worked out together, and it was like, wow, you know, I think maybe I need to do this. I was desperate. My wife was desperate too. So I started working out, and it took me 3 months to gain 5 pounds. And I was so excited. It took me a whole year to gain 10 pounds. I know some of you don't have that problem, right? Well, I have had that problem all of my life. So I'm up to 150 pounds, and I'm just ecstatic because I'd given up. My driver's license from high school was 151, and I thought, I got to just be honest with him and tell him 135, 140, you know? And I was so excited. But in the process of realization that I thought I was in shape, but I realized I wasn't, I went through this road of humiliation. It happened just a few weeks in. Ty had been working out for about a year. We both went to Andrews together. We were there with an evangelistic campaign that was taking place, and We were attending some of the classes there. We were there for a few weeks. And Ty was working out with the guys on campus, and he invited me to go with him. And of course, I wanted to, because I wanted to, you know, get in shape. Went down to the gym, and Ty goes to this group of young people, and he's on the bench press, and they got the bar up there, which is about 40 pounds without any weight on it, those Olympic bars. And then the guys there, you know, they throw a 45 on one side and they throw a 45 on the other side. You know, Ty's, no. Oh, can't do it again. Oh, they can't do it again. Oh, you know, and he's got these guys spotting him. And I'm like, wow. I sneak off. I was like, hey. And I said, oh, no, I'm going to go over here. I'll be over here. And I was looking for a spot, you know, like around the corner or somewhere where it was just really like vacant and abandoned. Nobody there. And I grabbed that bar, that 40-pound bar, without any weight on it. I'm serious. Trying to lift it above my head. Barely could get it up one time. Put it back down. Wow. Man, I didn't realize I was so weak. I didn't realize I was so wretched. I didn't realize I was so out of shape, so off. I thought I was healthy. I thought I was doing good. But here's the reality. But now I know what I need to do. I'm going to do it. And I'm going to keep doing it. Because this is the way. This is not a one-time thing. This is not a fad. This is commitment. I'm doing this. I'm going to keep doing it. And I just kept doing it. Just kept pushing that bar up, and pretty soon it got easier. I said, well, I better put some more weight on it, make it harder again. So put a little bit more weight on there. And pretty soon that got easier. Oh, put a little more weight on there. Make that hard again. And I have discovered that the hardest thing in the Christian experience is just daily connection with Jesus. Because we're so self-sufficient. We think we can get up in the morning, we can jump into our clothes, we can go out into our car, we can take off to work, we can go about our business and do whatever we want, and everything's going to be okay. We're so self-sufficient that way. And God says, you need me every moment of every day. It's time to make that commitment. It's time to put Jesus first. Which means not just some morning devotional time and scrapping out a little bit of, you know, prayer time and a little bit of study time and reading a line here. It means sitting down and thinking about how I can put Jesus into everything that I do in my day and in my week and in my life. Everything. Because that's why we have these handy dandy little media things, right? We can just turn this on and click a couple of buttons. And we're listening to the Bible. Right? Or we're listening to songs. Or we're listening to the Spirit of Prophecy, which, by the way, you can download free of charge from a number of websites, including some that we have links to at Lightbearers. You can take advantage of media, like media is taking advantage of you, or at least Satan's trying to take advantage of you, and pump your minds full of this stuff. And by the time you're done with your day or your week, you're wondering why it's so easy for you to sin or forget God or do things you don't want to do. And the reason is because Satan is the one that is feeding you full of this stuff. And you can choose to let Christ feed you. I've made that choice. I've taken this whole focus of exercise and realized that is a parable, if you will, of how weak I was spiritually, even though I thought I was strong, and how much I didn't realize that I needed Jesus, that I needed to work out and get strong spiritually, that I was in the Laodicean condition and am by nature Laodicean, thinking I'm rich and increased with goods and need what? Nothing. I went to prayer meeting this week. That'll keep me for a couple. I'm doing good. I had some time in devotions. The book of Revelation introduces us to the one thing we need to overcome. The one thing. As Jesus said, the one needful thing. One thing is needful. Mary has chosen that good thing, and guess what? Nobody's going to take it away. And tonight, Jesus wants us to make that choice. And when we do, nobody will take it away from us. Amen? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you again for the revelation of Jesus and for the story that is simple and profound, the outworking of that relationship that you long to have with us. Father, we ourselves are careless, indifferent at best. We disguise it in many ways, shapes, forms, for good reasons, like Martha. We want to take care of your business, of you. But you are urging us tonight and ever to sit at your feet, spend that time, connect, to allow your presence to be felt, your love to be realized in the languages that we need. That's why we've come here tonight, and that's why we are making ourselves available right now. Father, you read every heart, you know the needs that we have. I just ask that your Spirit will move upon each one. Show us where we can make commitments, where we can make time, how we can make time, what we can get rid of, what you can get rid of in our lives. Draw us to you. Renew our hearts. We pray in Jesus' name.